Let m and n be arbitrary non-negative integers. We need to show that 2m factorial into 2n factorial divided by m factorial into n factorial into m plus n factorial is an integer. This is a problem from IMO 1972. It's problem number 3. Remember IMO, it's a place where Asians in the US compete with Asians in China. Anyway, so if a over b is an integer and we take their prime factorization, that is p1 to the power a1, p2 to the power a2, and so on, divided by p1 to the power b1, p2 to the power b2, then if a over b is an integer, it must always be the case that ai is greater than or equal to bi for all I, for all positive i's. Right, simply because if bi is greater, then you would have a prime number, a prime factor left in the denominator, and so it cannot be an integer. Right, so before we can go ahead and work directly with prime factors and powers, let's first introduce a notation. It's a pretty common notation, that is Vp of n. Vp of n is basically asking the question that in the prime factorization of n, what is the power of p? Right, powers of p can be pretty important, especially in a case like this, and so there's a specific notation for this. So if I say, to give you an example, v2 of 24, the answer would be 3, because 24 is 2 cubed multiplied by 3. Right, so let's shift our focus to factorials. So if we are asking the question, okay, so for any prime p, we take some n factorial, what would be the value? So n factorial, let's just take something solid like v2 of, let's say 10 factorial, right? So 10 factorial is 10 into 9 into 8 into 7.
A few inches later.
Into 5, into 4, into 3.
So much later that the old narrator got tired of waiting and they had to hire a new one.
Into 1. Right, and we're asking, okay, once you're multiplying these, what are the powers of how many, what is the power of 2? So here we have one multiple of 2, here's the other multiple of 2, the other one, the other one, the other one. So there are 10 over 2 multiples of 2, and we actually need to round it down, because let's say this was 11 factorial, there will be 11 into this stuff, so we need to round down 11 divided by 2, round down 11 divided by 2, so 11 divided by 2 is 5.5. if we round it down, it would be just 5, and we can see there are 5 multiples of 2. Right, let me write over here the general case. So n over p1, right, p to the power 1, right? But now notice that some of them will have some of them will have 2 to the power 2, like 4 is 2 to the power 2, so we need to count 2 twice, and so we can look for, we can hunt for multiples of 4. There's one of them, there's the other, so this would be 11 divided by 4, rounded down. And okay, so this should be a round down, and for the general case it would be n over p squared, rounded down. And so again, by the same logic, here 8 has 2 cubed, so we need to add one more. This would be 11 divided by 8, rounded down. The general case, n divided by p cubed, rounded down. Right, and for 11 factorial, that's where we stop, because there's no 16 in there. But even if we write 11 over 16 round down, and then 11 over 32 round down, it doesn't really matter, because this would be 0, this would be 0, so you're just adding zeros. So to sum up, we can see that Vp of n factorial is equal to the sum of n over p to the power I, okay, so p to the power I from I equals 1 to infinity, and we round this down. It's called the floor function. Once we have this, we want to show that the Vp of numerator numerator is greater than or equal to Vp of the denominator, right? For all primes p, right? So the numerator is Vp of 2m factorial into 2n factorial, and then the denominator is m factorial into n factorial into m plus n factorial. And so if we write this in summation form, this would be sum from I equals 1 to infinity of 2m over p to the I, p to the I, right? We are currently focusing on just one prime, but you will see that it holds for every prime. So round this down, plus the sum of I equals 1 to infinity of 2n over p to the I, round this down. Oh, and actually we can combine these two because they are summations with the same limit. So we can combine these two, the sum of I equals 1 to infinity of 2m over p to the I, round it down, 2n over p to the I, round it down, close this, should be greater than or equal to the same thing, from 1 to infinity of, now we have m over p I, p to the I, plus n over p to the I, plus m plus n over p to the I, round it down, this should be floor function, and then sum all of these up. Right, so I can add these up, I can basically add these up, because 2m factorial into 2n factorial, if you concentrate on one prime and its power, let's say an, the power will basically be the power of p over here plus the power of p over here, simply because they are multiplying. So that's why we can add them up like so and like so. Right, so now we have this equality and we want to show that this sum is at least equal to or it can be greater than the other sum. And in fact, voice crack. And in fact, we can show something that is much more powerful, that for every I, this term is greater than or equal to this term. So we are going to show that the rounded down version of A, sorry, the rounded down version of 2a plus the rounded down version of 2b is always greater than or equal to rounded down version of a plus rounded down version of b plus rounded down version of a plus b, right? Where a and b are real numbers. In fact, here a is n over p to the I and b is, sorry, A is M over P to the I, B is N over P to the I. One thing to notice is that we can restrict our A and B to just decimals. So A and B are within the range 0 to 1. The reason why we can do that is simply because of how the factorials, how the round down works. So if I want to find 3.5 rounded down, I really just have to focus on the decimal part, because this is the same as 3 plus the round down of 0.5. In other words, if let's say a was 0.5, right, and I add 1 to it, the effect of adding 1 would be the effect of adding 2 here, which is the same as effect of adding 1 here and 1 here. In other words, it changes nothing for the equality. It's like saying plus a on the left and plus a on the right. It really just cancels out, right? So we have this domain restricted, and what we gain by restricting this domain is that now we can condense our case into just two cases. Case number one is that a plus b is less than 1. So maybe a is 0.4, b is 0.5, and so on. For all cases where a and b are less than 1, then this is obviously 0. Okay, so let me copy this over here. Uh, Right, so if a plus b is less than 0, this is obviously 0, this is also obviously 0. A plus b will also now be 0. Right, now 2b can be 0 or 1, 2a will also be 0 or 1. In any case, even if we take the worst case, that is it is 0, the equality still holds that it is equal. It is equal or it may be greater, but it is at least equal. Right, so case 1 works in our favor. If we now look at case 2, that should be the opposite of this. That is a plus b is greater than 1. So if a plus b is greater than 1, let me copy this again. Right, so if a plus b is greater than 1, then we can acknowledge the fact that at least one of them is greater than 0.5, simply because since we have restricted our domain from 0 to 1, right? So at least one of them needs to be greater than 0.5, and so let's say without loss of generality, a is greater than or equal to 0.5. All right, a and b, the rounded out version of a and b, are always 0 because of our choice of the this basically. And so this is 0, a plus b, we have said that a plus b is greater than 1, so this would be 1. Now 2a, since a is greater than or equal to 0.5, this is 1. And now 2b will either be 0 or it will be 1. Right, so if b is greater than or equal to 0.5, if b is also greater than 0.5, then this would be 1. If it is not, it is 0. In either case, even if it is 0, then we have 1 greater than or equal to 1, which is of course true, and 2 greater than or equal to 1, which is of course true. And so we are done with our proof. We have showed that the numerator, okay, so if this is numerator and denominator, and we take their prime factors, a2 all the way, p1, b1, p2, b2, all the way, we have shown that for each and every prime, this a1 is at least equal to this b1, and so it will always be the case that either it cancels out completely or there's p to some power left. In any case, we have basically shown that this would be an element of integers, positive integers, right? And we are done. QED.